Love is but a song we sing, and fear's the way we die. You can make the mountains ring or make the angels cry. Though the bird is on the wing and you may not know why. Come on, people, now smile on your brother. Everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Some may come and some may go, surely pass. When the one that left us here returns for us at last, we are but a moment's sunlight fading in the grass. People now, smile on your brother. Everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Come on, people now, smile on your brother. Everybody get together, try to love one another right now.
You will understand. You hold the key to love and fear on your trembling hand. Just one key unlocks them both. It's there at your command.
May God be with you. Welcome to worship outside, outdoors, and online here at Mount Olivet Lutheran Church of Plymouth. We are just so grateful. We get another little bit windy if you're at home, but a very tolerable September morning to gather together our focus this fall is space for community, and that means we all, in our still isolated, confined lives, need space to reach out to each other and also know that others are there for us. So this outdoor worship in September is one of the ways we're doing it, but we're still connecting online and through the miracle of technology and an amazing group of technicians and musicians, we are able to pull this off. So whether you're here or at your homes, welcome to worship today. A few little notes about the service. All of us who are gathered here, unless we're speaking on a mic, are masked up. So we invite you to respond as you would talk in worship, but we're going to leave the singing to the band because they are so good at it. We are all going to partake in communion. And if you're here, you have your own little communion wine or juice and a little wafer tucked into a little plastic cup. So if you don't have that already, go to a station where you can grab that and we will partake in communion today. Online, everything that you need is going to be on the screen. If you're here, we have bulletins for you as well. And we invite you to use your cell phone or your iPad or whatever you have with you today, because that's how we interact online in the sharing of the peace and the prayer. So no permission given to pull out your device during worship. And I also want to point out today that Pastor Joel and I are wearing red masks. We have 25 kids getting confirmed at 1 p.m. in their own outdoor service. Over 130 people are going to be here for that. And we're just thinking of those kids that weren't confirmed in the spring, but get the opportunity to do that now. They are now 10th graders, and we want to celebrate them, affirm them, and get them on their way to high school ministries. So for sure, a prayer for us today to think about those amazing kids and also gather together today and speak that. So all of our scripture this fall is about community, and we will dance between Old Testament and New. And today, a story from the Gospel of Mark, where four friends dig through a roof to lower their paralyzed friend to get close to Jesus. And I think Pastor Joel has something to say about this in space for community with us today. So as we begin our worship, we name the truth about the world and we name the truth about ourselves. We need time to be able to speak to God. What are those things that are not right in the world? And how have we been a part of that? What are those things that we've missed out that we should have been a part of? Speak those today to God individually. We do that collectively. And we find that God's mercy and grace shows up there. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us now confess our sin in the presence of God and one another. We confess together, most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together in Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Amen. We now let the band sing a great song.
tongues of highest praise. Give us wonder, give us awe. Give us strength to give our all. As one voice we give you glory, as we take part in your story. Let your fire fall. We are here, gathered in your name. Do you see what we celebrate?
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Creator God, you have connected us together in your love. When we can extend help to others, let us give it with humility. And when we need help from others, let us receive it with grace. Amen.
The reading this morning is from the Gospel of Mark. When he returned to Capernaum after some days, it was reported that he was at home. So many gathered around the front door that there was no longer even room for them, even at the front door, and he was speaking the word to them. Then some people came, bringing to him a paralyzed man, carried by four of them. And when they could not bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him, and having dug through it, they let down the mat on which the paralytic lay. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some of the scribes were sitting there, questioning them in their hearts, "Why does this fellow speak this way? It is blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone? At once Jesus perceived in his spirit that they were discussing these questions among themselves, and he said to them, "Why do you raise such questions in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Stand up and take your mat and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has the authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the paralytic, "I say to you, stand up, take your mat, and go to your home." And he stood up and immediately took the mat and went out before all of them, so that they were amazed and glorified God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Grace and peace to you all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our focus as a church this fall is space for community. Space and community, two really rich concepts. And neither is present at the beginning of this story from Mark's gospel. There is no space. There are so many people, it says, that there was no room at the door, not even in front of the entryway. And I don't see community either. See, just because people share a space doesn't mean they share a story or a sense of belonging or a common purpose. Instead, I imagine that everyone there is there for themselves. Everyone's come to Jesus with their own individual agenda. And this isn't necessarily bad. They're coming to see Jesus after all. I'm not going to get mad about that. But imagine for a moment if you showed up to see Jesus with the hopes that he would focus on your problems and found that you had to compete with a crowd of others to even get close to him. My guess is that you wouldn't feel like you were a part of a community. My guess is that you would see others as inconveniences, people who are getting in your way. So yes, you've got this crowd of people and they're together, but they're only thinking of themselves. And so there is no community, only people who are annoyed by each other. I don't know about you, but I feel like I could be part of that crowd. Right now in my life, it feels like there's still so much that's on hold or up in the air. All of the news just demoralizes me. And I'm isolated from people and activities that I love. It takes more energy for me to do fewer things. It is stressful right now. And when the stress gets this big for me, I find that my vision gets this big. My capacity gets this big. My compassion and patience and ability to go with the flow, they all get this big. I find myself clinging to a sense of control and predictability. I find myself swimming in the deep waters of my own insecurities. I feel myself become more rigid, wanting to get my way, wanting to get what I want, placing that at the center of things. So soon it seems to be the only thing that there is, and everything and everyone else feels like an inconvenience. I like cooking. The process of it actually brings me joy. And so this past Tuesday, I made myself the bargain that if I could work through the day without distraction, I would make myself this really involved, really delicious Middle Eastern meal where you have to deep fry a bunch of cauliflower and eggplant and hand grind your spices and make a broth from scratch and tie towels around your pot lids to mitigate the moisture levels. This is exciting stuff to me. And the bribe worked. I was really productive all day. And so I poured myself a glass of wine. I laid all my ingredients on the counter, turned on a soundtrack, greatest salsa hits, right? That's my cooking music. And a knock came at the door. A friend of ours had walked a mile and a half with his 3-year-old daughter to surprise us and hang out in our backyard. And I saw him and opened the door and went, "Yay! It's so good to see you!" And then my friend pulled something out of the stroller and said, "We brought you zucchini from our garden. Each zucchini weighs 5 pounds and we want to share them with you." And I was like, "Oh, great. Now we got to get rid of a ton of zucchini too." I could not receive the gift of his presence, nor his zucchini. I was too brittle. I was too shrunk down in myself. It didn't matter that he had walked a mile and a half with a 3-year-old. I was the one who was inconvenienced. I had no space within me to handle disruption. And community is always disruptive. Look at Mark's gospel. You've got this crowd of annoyed individuals, and then you've got this genuine community. 5 folks coming together down the road, working with one another, sharing a burden because they love their friend. And what do? They tear a hole in the roof. They disrupt the flow of the day. They disrupt the private agenda of every disgruntled person in that crowd with love and concern for their friend. And that's what community does. It tears a hole in the roof. It blows things open that we were hoping would stay closed. It lets in new light and new air. It creates space for forgiveness and healing and restoration. It's good, but it really is a disruption and an inconvenience. Yet, this disruption of community is where Jesus' healing and transformation and new life are made known. Consider this. In this story, no one who comes to Jesus by themselves, for themselves, is healed or changed in any way. The only one in this story to get healed is the one who is brought there by his friends. Mark tells us that it's their faith that Jesus sees, not the faith of this man, but the faith of his friends. And that's what launches Jesus into action. And to me, at least, the lesson here is clear. The way God works is through our neighbor. Think about it. When we say the Apostles' Creed, this confession of who God is, we say, "I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church." We say it every week. The Spirit shows up in community. We are part of the way that God chooses to show up in the world. The God we have chooses to be made known when we gather, when our sense of purpose and belonging is extended. When we are coaxed out of our self-sealing spheres of our cares and concerns, God shows up to us in our neighbors who tear a hole in our roofs so that new light and new air get in. In many ways, the people in the crowd around Jesus are right. We are inconveniences to each other, but that is a blessing. That is the point. That is how God shows up to open space within us, drawing us out of ourselves into the world and into God's presence to heal us and restore us and forgive us. Can you imagine how different this story would be if the crowd of people understood each other this way? Not as obstacles standing in each other's way, but as blessed inconveniences. What healing might have been achieved? What power? What transformation? Thank goodness for these friends who show up. They show us, 2 millennia later, a different way of being in the world, a way that knows and trusts that God is found in community. In different times, the rest of this sermon would be pretty straightforward. I'd encourage you to be like those friends, right? To think about who it is in your life that you are meant to reach out to and have faith for. But I think about our world. I think about where we are today, what we're all living through, and who God is calling us to be and what God is calling us to do. And I wonder if we are less like the friends who take on more work and more weight, and we're more like the man on the mat. Sure, most of us can walk, but we are still frozen and overwhelmed by what we are living through. And what if we need right now isn't a call to do more and take more responsibility? What if what we need is people whose presence in our lives carries us into healing and forgiveness and new life? People to gracefully disrupt our shrinking vision, blowing a hole in the roof of our worried and insular thinking. As a church, we think that what God is doing right now in this time is inviting us to be blessed inconveniences to one another. And so this fall, we are asking you to think about your days and weeks and ask where you are meant to find space for community. We know it. We know you are not getting the kind of organic, life-giving connection here at Worship that has fed you and given you life. And so we have built other spaces for you to come into contact with each other and draw each other out of whatever small story you're living through into the big story that God writes with all of us and through all of us. And there's a lot of opportunities for you to do this. We've got Sunday morning coffee hours, Monday conversations about the Bible, Tuesday conversations about equity, places to pray on Wednesday mornings and evenings, on top of all the activity and faith groups and youth programming that we have already. We simply want each of you to join one of these spaces this fall and see what happens. Not all of them, simply one. I know it's a big ask. We're all exhausted and reluctant to take on any more than we have already. Even as a pastor, even as someone who gets paid for doing this, there's part of me that doesn't want to give up all my evenings. But I know that these inconveniences are blessings. because they will draw me into community, and community will draw me into God's presence. And I trust that it will be true for you too. So don't sign up because you feel like you should, or to be good, or to do more. Do it because your roof needs a new hole. Do it to let your roof get torn open and new light and new air get through. Do it because community can bring your vision and compassion and ability to go with the flow from here to here. Do it because it might be the way that your friends bring you to Jesus. This past Tuesday, my friend's surprise visit tore a hole in the vision I had for my evening. And I've got to admit, at first, when I sat in the backyard with him, I was bitter. But eventually, I relaxed into our time together. I got to hear about his work and his family. I got to see how his daughter is growing and picking up vocabulary and developing an imagination. It was good to be together, holy even. A blessed inconvenience. It wasn't what I had planned, but it was what I needed. Because his visit and his presence took me from here to here. And I couldn't have done that on my own. And the next night, I ended up making that Middle Eastern dish, garnished with a homemade yogurt sauce. And in that sauce was shredded zucchini. And it really made the meal. Amen.
All right, we have a Jason Mraz tune that we're going to sing for you this morning.
Look for the good in everything. Look for the people who will set your soul free. It always seems impossible until it's done. Look for the good in everyone. Your soul free. It always seems impossible until it's done. Look for the good in everyone. People don't go crazy. People don't go mad. People don't forget the superpowers we all have. People want to love, not hate. We can decide our fate and look for the good in everyone. Celebrate our love most days if there's a silver lining.
Silver lining.
Still have to find it, find it, find it. Look for the good in everything. Look for the people who will set your soul free. It always seems impossible until it's done. Look for the good in everyone. Everyone needs sunshine. Everyone needs rain. Everyone is carrying around some kind of pain. I see who you are. You're just like me. I see you searching for a purpose, guided by a dream. I see who you are. I'm just like you. I get lost sometimes and I forget what I came here to do. I keep on trying.
Keep on trying.
On what's frightening. Look for the good in everything. Look for the people who will set your soul free. It always seems impossible until it's done. Look for the good. Look for the good. Look for the good in everyone. Love in light in vibration. Look for the good. Look for the good. Everyone gets mad sometimes, and maybe they should. Look for the good. Look for the good. Yeah, look out for all of the heroes in your neighborhood. Look for the good. Look for the good. Life sure would be sweeter if everybody would. Look for the good in everything. Look for the people who will set your soul free. It always seems impossible until it's done. Look for the good. Look for the good. Look for the good in everyone.
As God's story, the power of that story stirs among us here and everywhere, we confess our faith, the faith of the church, using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We are about to share the peace and collect our offering. But before we do that, each and every week at Mount Olivet, we tell a story of impact. What a difference it means to be a belonging community, and how that kind of ripples out into the world, tears through things that can be barriers or keeping us away. And today, a story about, we call it MOPC, which means Mount Olivet Parents Connect. It started several years ago as we noticed in the sanctuary, I like to call it the baby bullpen, which is a family ministry area with young families with little kids trying to sit through worship. And parents were sweating, but they knew this is what they wanted to do for their kids. So their kids knew this place was for them, and we were changed by it. So these families have gotten together and formed this collaborative group who so innovatively connects with each other so they can have adult contact and the kids can play, and they're nurturing faith and they're showing up for each other in their lives through things like death of a spouse, loss of jobs, the craziness of being young parents trying to manage kids care and working and all of that. And somehow they've continued to do it. They have a full fall planned, even when we can't physically be together. And we just celebrate all those ways that community is being stirred and built and connected here because of this church, because of this community. So Mount Olivet Parent Connect, we're so grateful for you and all the ways that you're making this happen for each other. We're very grateful. So we're going to share the peace. Take out your phone and share the peace with those who are online. If you're online, share the peace with those who are there. And I just want to take a moment and say thank you for your ongoing giving. A little bit harder to feel it when we don't pass the offering plate here. 60% of our families give online, so that is something that we know that's coming in. And so many of you and other people across the country mail envelopes in with checks. Generous to make all that is Mount Olivet happen, and so we're grateful for that. You can give online through the online screen that way, or creatively give however, and we're so deeply grateful for that. So we're going to listen to some more good music as we share the peace and we extend our offering and investment in Mount Olivet.
I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me who I am, just who I am, because I need to know. Oh, you say I am loved when I can't feel a thing. You say I am strong when I think I am weak. You say I am held when I am falling short. Matters now is everything you think of me. In you I find my worth, in you I find my identity. I am yours.
So in all my words there, I forgot passing the peace if we're here outdoors, that we could like stand up and share the peace with those around you. So thank you for those who like moved and gave the peace sign to us. I didn't mean to keep you so in your seats. We are about to partake in communion. If you're here, you have the little cup, the wafers on the top. I will give you the signal when you can eat the bread and the wine. It's a little confusing because the flow is a little bit different. Communion is the feast that makes us one, and we are united with God and all our family in Christ. And so those who are here and those who are gathered in their homes and people who share this meal across the world, God's table is wide enough for all. So no matter where you are welcome here and there is a place for you. And so if you're here outside at church, we will commune using our own individual containers. W means wine on your little cup and J means juice. And all the crackers are gluten-free, just to make sure that you open that cracker side first. If you're at home, you can use whatever you have gathered, since we have a God who uses ordinary things in order to bring us his grace. And if you're not taking communion today, you are no less a part of God's family or our church community, and we will give you a blessing. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, broke it, and gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." So together, as one community, we pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. If you're not receiving communion, receive this blessing. God bless you, strengthen you, and make you whole. And if you are sharing in communion, whether right here or at home, hear this good news. The body of Christ is given for you as you take the bread, and the blood of Christ is shed for you. And I think about Pastor Joel's words on this wonderfully detailed, odd, creative story, how digging that hole in the roof brings in something that we may not know we know, that we need. It takes us from here to here. And that's what this meal does. Ordinary means wherever you are, taking you from here to here in community to reveal God's love for you. Come, let us eat with thanksgiving. God comes to us by grace and unites us as one.
So little, you are the head,
are your body. We walk in your direction, finding our perfection. Everything holds together. Hold us together. Everything holds together in you. Everything holds together. Hold us together. Everything holds together in you. You are the King who bled for peace. Put the nations back together. Show us how to live forever. Yeah, yeah. Show us how to live forever, yeah, yeah. Ooh. Show us how to live forever. Everything holds together. Hold us together. Everything holds together in you. Everything holds together. Hold us together. Everything holds together in you. Everything holds together in you. Everything holds together in you.
And now may the presence of Jesus strengthen you and bring you God's grace through community. Amen. So now is our time to pray at Mount Olivet. Whether you're here or you're online, you can start typing your prayers in the comments, and I read those aloud, and we pray together as community. It's who we are here at Mount Olivet, that we know when we are forgiven and fed and brought together, we declare to God those things where we need God to show up. And when God shows up, he often calls us to those places as well. And hear this today. Whatever you're going through right now, joy, suffering, unknown, feeling paralyzed, isolated, alone, not what the next step is, that you have a community here that walks with you in that. And when we dare to speak those prayers, somehow those barriers, those walls between us, those roofs, they dissipate more, and we're connected. So as you type away, I'm going to start first. Just pray for these amazing 25 10th graders. And I want to pray for their small group leaders. We call them guides here at Mount Olivet. Carla Schoenberg and Chris Olson, Bruce Finley, Craig Opp, and Joe Schwartz. Who have walked with these kids some since the fifth grade. And they have met together on Wednesday nights and gone through retreats and made stoles and all these things. And those adults will tell you that they are changed by these kids. And the kids will tell you the best part of confirmation has been their small groups. And so we give thanks for that call, that they said yes to that big commitment. And that they continue to accompany these kids as they show up in the world in their faith. And so for this service that starts at 1, to affirm the faith of the kids here at Mount Olivet and this promise that God made to them at the baptismal font, that he would always be with them and this community would know and celebrate their call in the world, we give thanks. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All right. Diane, we're praying with you. Your friend Deb, whose husband John received kidney and pancreas transplant over this past week. And overall, he's doing well, but healing is definitely a roller coaster, as God had noted would happen. So for John, major transplant surgery.
for the marvel of science, and yet for the individual nuance of bodies to receive, and to know within this prayer that there was a death for someone in those organs too. So as God's story unfolds and weaves together for all of this, we pray, God, for healing, for your deep sense of presence, for all who care for John, Deb, and for you and your family as you stay close during this time, and Diane, for you as friend. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Mark, we're praying with you prayers of comfort and peace to the family of Julie Ebel. Julie passed away suddenly yesterday from COVID, and she was 45 years old. God, we pray for Julie's life, and for now this life that you promise her in death. 45 is way too young. For all this unravels in our hearts, for people who think this disease isn't real, this virus doesn't have impact, for stories like this for us to hear, how do we keep each other safe? How do we persevere during this time that feels safe, yet it is still so dangerous? For Julie's family, as they make their way through this next day, the next breath, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Marcus, you're praying a prayer of thankfulness. You had a hole in your garage roof. Wow, talk about the gospel being real for you. That was repaired this weekend. And so for the Renberg family, in this time of repair, God, in your mercy, hear a prayer. Angela, we're praying with you for Jessica and Richard as they travel back to New York City this week. Yes, we pray for you, safe travel, Jessica and Richard, as you go back to a place with a lot going on, for your own safety, for the safety and health of that city, and for your travel, and for your parents who are concerned and love you. God, in your mercy, hear a prayer. Yeah, Kathy, happy birthday. Judy McCall, prayers of thanksgiving for your mom's birthday today. Judy, happy birthday to you. I trust that you're going to hear this message. We celebrate your life, and for all the ways your families and others are coming close to celebrate you, we join you in that. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Marlene, hi, Marlene. We're praying for you as well. Your son-in-law, Randy, with internal bleeding and unknown as of yet what's going on. So, Randy, we are praying for you and all that's going on in your body, for that to be diagnosed and to be treated, for your healing. Marlene, for you as mother-in-law, deep love and trust and faith from you as you accompany your family during this time. God, in your mercy, hear a prayer. Yeah, Angela, for our nation as we grieve the loss of Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, for the voice this justice gave to women, for her tenure and service to our country, and for a voice of justice, for a legacy to be made known. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sue is here. Sue Syme, happy birthday. Ron just put a little note. There's a lot of birthdays today. Happy birthday, Sue. It's nice to see your mass face and to be a part of your celebration. Thanks for coming to worship today. For your life, we give you thanks. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Teresa, we're joining with you, your 16-year-old nephew who now has COVID. So another name to this disease. For this time, we pray for healing, for care in the midst of the unknown and the worry. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Prayers for healing for Jim Hansen, Eric. We're praying with you. He's being treated for congestive heart failure and fluid on the heart and lungs. God, be with Jim in this very serious time with his body. We pray that he will get the right care and medical treatment. And Eric and Lisa, for you, for love for your family, God, in your mercy. Yeah, Vicki is joining the prayers for all that's going on in our nation, tearing us apart, and speaking again on the death of the justice for all of us who during this time of uncertainty in our nation and all those ways of polarization and unclear direction on what is next, and it feels like one more thing always. God, show up with peace in your people for this message again of showing up for each other, that God is revealed when we care for our neighbor. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Joe, offering that same prayer, that collective work and the contributions, equity work here in our country, as we remember Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Rita, pray for each member of our community, our state, and our nation during this divisive and contentious, really difficult time, especially for the homeless and unemployed. Those prayers of Rita, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For your mom, Diane Joyce, to experience more peace than stress, we join you praying for your mom. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jan, we join you. Prayers for Scott Lingy's cousin, Susie, who's home still without power after the destruction in Cedar Rapids. And so we continue to be mindful for all those people who don't have enough right now. Natural disasters across the country, individual needs and community needs. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jeannie, we're praying with you. Lots of birthdays. Lucas is 8 today, or he was 8 on Friday, and he was able to be together with his grandparents. So we celebrate with your family. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hi, Jill. We're praying with you. Prayers for the people and the creatures that were affected by the winds and rains brought by Hurricane Sally. We join you in that. Jill, I know you're in Florida, and for all the people there impacted, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Paulette, hi, Paulette, good morning. We're praying with you for all parents making difficult decisions about childcare and distance learning. All that is going on in the midst of families, lots of unsettled times, not knowing what's ahead, just taking it day by day. For teachers as well and administrators in our communities together in all of this. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. If you don't have a device, you can submit a prayer request online. Our prayer team is so good about going back to these comments and praying on your behalf. And if you walk back up to our main door at church anytime, you will see some socially distanced chairs and a little prayer box. You can write your prayer. And also just some quiet space if you want to pray either there or our labyrinth out here as well. So God, for all these things that we have prayed today, and we end our prayer time in this prayer of good courage, and I invite you to join me. Oh God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you all for joining us in person and also online. It's always a joy to be together, even when together means things that it has a different meaning now. It's still a joy, though. For those of you who are here in person, you can recycle your bulletins. You might have to tuck the plastic bag back in the recycling bin. If you want to recycle your communion cups, too, that's fine. You just need to tear off and throw away the pieces of paper. Otherwise, it's no good, and all the recycling gets thrown out. And then just a reminder, next week is our final week of outdoor worship. We need you to register online so that we can know that you're coming and know that you're doing, keeping your promise to be safe and not put anyone else in the congregation at risk. We're really glad that you registered today. Encourage you, and for those of you online as well, to register again for next week. We've been talking about space for community. Some of those offerings at our church to be community, to get connected with each other, are starting up pretty soon. So if you go to our website, it's right on the homepage. Big menu of options for everything that we're doing this fall. Click on the Space for Community link. You can find out more about how to sign up. Oh, and then next week, if you not only register to attend worship, we're going to need some volunteers as well. I know that would make Angela very happy. So if you're here, if you're around, if you don't mind showing up a little bit early, we need your help. This is a community putting this on. It's not staff doing it for you. It's us doing it together as the people of God. Pastor Beth mentioned already our space to lament. If you just need to give something over to God, go ahead and do that. Anytime you want to pull up at church and sit in those chairs, feel free to do so. Two other opportunities to pray in community on Wednesdays, both of them. There's a centering prayer group that Pastor Beth is going to lead in the mornings. Wednesday is often the day when I personally feel like, oh my goodness, how am I going to get through the week? And so to pause and to rest in God's presence with others, led by Pastor Beth, that's an opportunity. And then in the evening, Wednesday evening, the examine prayer, this ancient practice of looking at your day with boldness enough to name where God was, to notice how each day is being made sacred, and by where God is appearing to you and your neighbor. So I will commend those opportunities for you. They should be on the space for community as well. Receive this blessing. Go forth into the world in justice. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, honor everyone. And God, Source, Word, and Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
What would you do if I sang out of tune?
All right, if we can have the green section over here, go ahead and start going.
Lend me your ear and I'll sing you a song, and I'll try not to sing out of key. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. I get by with a little help from my friends. I get by with a little help from my friends. What would I do when my love is away?
Does it worry you to be alone?
How do I feel at the end of the day?
Are you sad because you're on your own?
No.
All right, all blue section people can go, and yellow can begin to go.
I get by with a little help from my friends. I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends. Do you need anybody? I want
red
somebody
section. Go ahead and circle it.
Could it be anybody? I want somebody to love.
Would you believe in a love at first sight?
Yes, I'm certain that it happens all the time.
What do you see when you turn out the light?
I can't tell you, but I know it's mine.
Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends.
I get by with a little help from my friends. I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends. Do you need anybody? I just need someone to love. Could it be? I want somebody to love. I get by with a little help from my friends.
I get by with a little help from my friends. I'm gonna try with a little help from my friends. Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. A little help from my friends.